has got to deal with that. So whichever government, whichever minister, whichever bureaucrat is in place, so his view is the only thing which matters to us finally.
I empathize with you, Vasu. I think those who are budding entrepreneurs, social entrepreneurs, you must understand the risk of actually, and you must prepare yourself for martyrdom, because that's what social entrepreneurship is for. There's no confusion in my mind, Vasu. Chances of survival are low, risks are very high, and you are competing with, your situation is not even David versus Goliath, it's actually way beyond that. But then you need to be very passionate about it, and I hope Vasu remains passionate despite facing the situation that he is in. That brings me to the question, I think it will be great to actually hear Pravesh's point of view, a person who has actually been involved in the developmental side despite being a bureaucrat, and a very long civic bureaucrat at that. He has actually had some very forward-looking policies in different states and in other places. Pravesh, your point of view, because I know you have seen things from all sides, and what is it that, and I would actually really want you to touch upon, what happens if you see us in a hostile situation with the government? Should we only pray to God, or are there other ways to find ourselves out?
Can I stand up there? Answer this. No, I think I'd like to engage the floor. First of all, I think, let me place the context of this discussion, and forgive me for saying so, but I have come here not because I see that I must defend one side of a very hostile relationship. I am certainly one of those people privileged to have extremely, I think, strong links with people in the social enterprise sector, and I have benefited tremendously from their work and experience. So I'm going to put this discussion first in a context, and then I'm going to make three very brief points about this relationship between the state. I would not use the word government, because I think that's limiting it to a very small part of the state. I think it's a larger relationship, and I think that social enterprise is very much embedded in this larger structure. And I'll take half a minute to start this context discussion by quoting from any textbook on political theory if you pick up. Every state in history, irrespective of whether it was the Roman state or the Mauryan state or the North Korean state or the Indian state, there are three things that every state seeks. Number one is legitimacy. Every state has to have some rationale for its existence. It can be a divine logic, it can be democracy, it can be an ideology like communism. So legitimacy is the first thing that every state is seeking. The second universal phenomena is in fact universality, which means a state seeks to be present everywhere in the territory that it seeks to control. And the third goal, which is what I think is relevant today, is that it seeks impact.
So as Sunil said, it's best not to be aware of the whole sector and come and start talking about it. So it's good that I have only 5 minutes to speak, because I probably can't speak more than that. And listening to Pravesh and Bhatti also, the whole debate versus profitability and social impact, I would probably like to focus my thoughts on that and just share what I believe. I think any objective that you want to achieve, if you create a commercially successful, self-sustainable model, that's probably the best thing to do. Whether it's a social objective that you have or any other commercial objective you have. To me, as Vinit said, I'm really confused. Providing water, safe drinking water to society, is in its context, is clearly a social objective. But just imagine if it's to be profitable. Just imagine what you said, social energy is coming into the system because private entrepreneurship, the profit motive coming into it, and making it a commercially viable objective and durability. It would make a huge amount of difference where probably the government probably don't even need to own the developmental objective of providing safe drinking water to society. Right? So in that context, I think social entrepreneurship is fundamentally an area which today is not commercially viable. It's very important for the society to achieve as an objective, and therefore the government would clearly play a role, but our target or our objectives should be in in some way or the other make it self-sustainable, profitable and commercial. And in that particular context, it may or may not happen. You know, all developmental objectives cannot be achieved like that. But if I were to look at the MFI example today, and I just look at the SKS microfinance numbers, in 5 years, from a 10 crore sales, it's talking about 1,000 crore sales, from a 10% profitability numbers to a 30% profitability numbers. The growth of microfinance, I doubt if it would have happened if it were not to be a commercially viable objective. I have no authority at all to comment whether it has met the social objectives that were set up, whether it has actually, but if the growth and in some sense or the other, we have actually led to some kind of financial inclusion and the cost of loan being reduced from 36% to 40% in the initial phase has gone down to 26%. Trust me, working in the rural India, that's an amazing, amazing, amazing success story. Whatever I have known of it, and the ideal thing would be that let competition take over completely and get it down to 10% of profitability for microfinance. And the only way and successful way of doing it is that competition completely take it over. So in the context of social entrepreneurship, I do believe that it should be possible for us at some level to make the social development objectives and initiatives commercially viable. If it's not possible, government would continue to play a significant role. If it is viable, at that point of time, I believe government should become the regulator and enforcer of the law rather than actually being an active participant in running that particular objective company. So that's a set of thought process I can share with you.
Thanks, Pankaj. So this brings me to the person who I have actually, whose speeches I have gone through quite in detail. Mrs. Thorat has a fairly wide-ranging interest and has played a very critical, or has actually seen the financial inclusion agenda from very close, but has interest that goes beyond financial inclusion itself. I think enough has been said, and I know you have actually a lot of points ready, and most of us would be curious to hear your point of view on the debate that's going on. So ma'am, over to you.
It's not as if the state sector wants to speak from the podium. But I guess it's just the more direct interaction. It's very interesting for me listening to the variety of shades, which really, I think in a sense, illustrates the whole issue here. Because if we really believe that the role of the state is to provide basic education, basic health care, and basic water and sanitation, and I probably would add basic financial services, then there would be no role for private sector, NGO sector, governments, non-governmental sector, social sector at all. And traditionally, if we do look at large societies and economies in the world, it is true that the government has provided these basic requirements, and in many societies, basic requirements free, which is totally a part of the fiscal budget. And this illustrates Vasu's first point. After all, if the government has made a provision in the budget, and you're putting 400 crores and 200 crores and thousands of crores, then we should be getting an outcome which is very different from what we have seen. And if the answer to the question that the bureaucrat asked him should have been, if that is the case, then why do we have clients? Why is it a poor consumer comes to a private health service or a private tuition class or a private doctor in a slum? Why? If the government sector is supposed to do this and is supposed to and will do it free, and is doing it, then what? Why would a person come at all? It's because clearly there is government failure. And why government has to be here is because there is market failure. You see, this whole thing is public goods cannot be provided by commercially, I mean, it cannot be commercially viable by definition. If you have to have it commercially viable, it will not be affordable, at least not till you scale up. And to scale up, you really have to be able to charge the minimum things to build up the kind of capital to make further investments and then to really reap the benefits of economies of scale. And so, if you really said that this has to be commercially viable and this is a social good, it is a public good, and I think then we are talking totally, we are talking at cross purposes. So I think let's fundamentally understand what is the role of the state, and therefore let us look and see where does the state, private or state, NGO, state, social sector participation come. It's amazing what the private sector or the non-governmental sector can do, because there's no sector which can innovate as well as this sector. There's no sector, whether it is a profit motive or whether it is philanthropy or whether it is altruism or whether it is some other motivation that is driving the private person, the non-governmental person. There is either passion or there is profit. So both these motives work very well, because it leads to certain amount of efficiencies, it leads to certain amount of trying to get good return on the effort and the resource invested. I won't just say the money invested. So I think it's important, and when you have this, then you get a lot of innovation that is going. And where is it, and clearly government is not able to deliver. So how can government then take advantage of this enterprise, of this creativity, of this innovation, to really be able to scale up and do justice to your own budgets? So one example clearly is where it is outsourced. Now they found they could not run good quality educational institutions with the kind of fees they thought was reasonable. So they actually decided to hand over the schools to the government for state funding, but because they got state funding, they had to abide by the rules of the education department and the interference of the education department. And that's when the problem started. The problem started, okay, it was okay for the education department to insist that they have inclusive schools so that they don't have any discrimination in admission. They should take all the children from the locality, whoever wanted to take in that particular area. But when the department started saying this should be the minimum requirements of the teachers, or this is the kind of teachers you should recruit, or they started interfering in who you should recruit and started playing favors, then the quality started diminishing. And as long as that was not there, these schools, because of their mission, because of their passion, and because they simply could not afford to run affordable schools with their own resources, certainly not commercially viable, they did want to take state funding, and state funding would have done a wonderful job had they allowed these managements to run the schools on their own without interfering. But this could be a good model going forward. Then I thought to myself of the kind of examples we have of Shankar Netralaya, of Narayan Hridayalaya, of Arvind maybe, of VHS, which provide good affordable medical care to large numbers. Now, most of the way they are able to do it is they run efficiently, they run with very good social objectives, because of the donations and grants they get. Fundamentally, it's because of that. Now, here the government's role is really